This is In Studio, and I'm your host, Marcia Morrison. And I am here with Mark Brown, and today we're going to talk about one of my favorite things, space toys and robots. Mark has an upcoming show all about robots, actually.
Robot Riot.
Robot Riot.
It is.
Okay, Robot Riot, perfect name. Mm-hmm. It's going to be November 9th at the Old Town Hall in the East Hampton City Arts Gallery from 5 to 8. It coincides with our monthly art walk, which I'm sure some of you are familiar with. And I absolutely insist that you go see it because it's going to be phenomenal. But anyway, before I get a chance to introduce you more to Mark and to the wonderful things that are lying here behind me, all of his work that he does on robots, I have to tell you how thrilled I am to actually be here because I am a robot baby. I love science fiction. I wandered through his studio earlier, saw the books The Science Fiction Galaxy and Vintage Toys, and I was in heaven. So Mark, take it away. Behind me, you have some wonderful things here.
Right. Well, this is several of the robots that will be in the Robot Riot show. We're going to have probably, I'd say, about at least 30 robots, all different sizes.
Great.
And some are, you know, smaller, like this one, and then some are quite a bit bigger. They're going to be on what I call towers, because I've made these pedestals out of the larger shapes to put the robots on top of them. And some of them are 84 inches, so it actually changes your relationship with the robot. Instead of looking down on it like you're the giant, you know, the robots are actually looking down on you. So that's kind of a
big brother.
You know, it's like this one right here. He's
exactly
on top of the world. So, you know, he's striding on top of the world. So could be a metaphor there. the robots are, you know, attacking you, or, you know, at least intimidating you a little bit. But basically, robots are fun because of what Marcia was saying. You know, they have this history of being played with and being accepted as kind of a fun thing. There are some scary ones, but mostly they're kind of fun, you know, because, you know, you have that association with them as toys and with them as characters in either movies or television shows. So
we have some of these robots here. Let's take a look at this guy right here. And, you know, I'm just fascinated. Where do these various things come from, and how did he end up looking like this?
Okay.
You know?
Well, you know, of course, they all tell a little story. Mm-hmm. Figurative art in general and robots, you know, are very very much like a story. So I, you know, I was talking to you earlier. Mm-hmm. I said we start with the head, because that's the character that the robot becomes, is the head. So robots are very abstract in a way because they can take numerous kinds of shapes. They don't have to be square. They don't have to be round.
Right.
They can be any shape. So in that way, they're very abstract, but they're also very prescribed because, you know, when you put the antenna on or the feet on, it becomes a robot. You know, everybody sees that. Everybody, you know, kind of buys into that. Well, this particular one right here is made from a T-tin right here. This is a one that I used to get from Barnes & Noble. You know, mm-hmm. If you've ever been to the, you know, the cafe at Barnes & Noble,
right,
they sell coffee. So I oftentimes try to find things that are multiples and that are very colorful and that are, of course, going to be thrown away or recycled so I can utilize them. But this particular T-tin, they came in five or six different colors, and for probably a period of about 3 or 4 years, I got them until they stopped making them in that particular type of T-tin.
I want to talk about color, because I remember the robots from my past, with Robbie the robot and the Lost in Space robot and the one from the day the Earth stood still, were all kind of the silver metallic. And you had a sense that that said, oh, that's a metal we don't have on Earth, number
right.
one, and yeah. that means they're from outer space. And,
right.
of course, we know that was the age of aluminum, so
right.
aluminum
right.
was everywhere. But
right.
this one's got a color scheme. So.
Well, that's right. It turns out that what you're saying is very interesting, because when I first started making the robots, I made them all silver and black with a few accents, maybe red, you know, a few other little accents, because I was kind of tied into that aesthetic. And like you were saying, this was age of aluminum in the mm-hmm. 50s. This was like, you know, in the 60s, the astronaut goes to the moon.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it was all, you know, a cultural thing that got reflected not only in the actual spaceships, but mm-hmm. in the actual products that people had in their homes.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
exactly.
Like everybody had those aluminum cookware or aluminum ice cube trays.
And, right, right.
And sometimes, you know, as they got a little more fancy, they started anodizing them. And anodizing is
yes.
is a process where they colorize the aluminum.
Mm-hmm.
And it had a very specific, very unique color that didn't exist anywhere else
mm-hmm.
because it was actually in the metal. It was electrified in these big vats, and the color went into the metal. So when I first started doing the silver, there were hundreds and hundreds of different shapes to use. And so gradually, I began to miss the color, the range of colors
mm-hmm.
that
mm-hmm.
I wanted to use. So I began to look at other containers, like this T10 right here, and this is a fossil watch container, you know. And interestingly enough, of course, they fit together nicely because proportionally they all work, but also the fossil company that makes all the watches, they sort of go for the nostalgia and also for that vintage kind of feel in their packaging. So there's when you give up something, like the silver, you get something else, but of course you leave some things behind. So, you know, just like, you know, we were talking earlier before we started shooting about Picasso, he gives up something like cubism and he gets something else. So that's this phase right now. What we're doing is we're doing color because I'm very partial to color, and I think it animates the robots in a way that the silver doesn't. It kind of puts them in, especially with the language. You can see on some of the robots here, there's language like from, let's just take a look at this. You know, like this particular can here, we use a lot of these soda cans. These are vintage soda cans, and you can tell just by looking at them that they're by the color and the lettering, and they come from a different time than the, you know, the modern ones. They're very simple. There's no barcode. There's no none of that kind of extraneous designs that they put on nowadays. And the color's beautiful. So when you're looking for something to make a robot out of, then I look for things like that that really speak, of really strong design and strong color.
You know, I'm just noticing here, and I'm trying to be creative and build my own robot with, mm-hmm. you know, and you've got here a crush can, and you've got this wonderful little tin here that
right.
has these colors, and then you've got a squirt can. So right here you've got the three, the color scheme, you know,
right. that
these two cans reflect the color scheme in that, and you
right.
can build off of that. And then you've got these great, what are these?
Those are poker chips,
okay.
just like, you buy in the store. And we colorize or paint, a lot of the elements,
mm-hmm.
like in the robots, to match what's going on in the tins, you know.
And then you got this little Altoids thing here.
Right. Well, you know, we haven't gotten to that part yet.
Okay, we'll talk about that later.
Yeah, we'll
okay.
come back to that.
But, you know, I love the fact that you've got some of these guys, they have hats on, some have round heads, some have square heads. This one over here behind me, I was fascinated by because we talked about earlier that the Japanese post-World War II were kind of putting out a lot of toys for us. And I do remember Made in Japan, Made in Japan, Made in Japan.
Made in Japan, yeah. And Made in Japan used to be kind of a negative thing.
Right.
Because
yes, exactly.
It symbolized something which was, in a particular way, not well made. But these companies that made the robots, they made them actually quite well and so inexpensive that they became so popular in the United States that it introduced, you know, generations of kids to playing with robots. So they became kind of part of their psyche, so to speak.
And you know, the other thing about it is now that all these toys that came out, a lot of them were science fiction based robots, right, and that came out of that time. If you go to auctions now, you're going to pay a lot of money for those
right.
toys because
right.
they are collector's items.
Right.
And this particular one back here that I'm going to refer to, and I hope we can get a shot of this, is on a Chinese checker stand, which
right.
I remember playing as a kid.
Right.
And the neat thing about it is it's got this Chinese language. And China
language.
Also was putting out a bunch of robot toys, if I'm right, or toys at that time. I'm not sure. But that kind of, for me, places this in a whole different place. And this Ritz can up here.
Right.
It's funny when you begin to identify these tins, and then they go away, and the tins and the stand morph into this is part of the robot, basically.
Right. Exactly. You know, the Ritz crackers up here, which is kind of ubiquitous, you know, they make Ritz crackers, but those cans that they came in were, you know, very, very iconographic. And I'm using the crackers here as I've eliminated the word Ritz because I didn't want that to interfere with the design. I wanted it to, you know, not be something that the design became about the word Ritz. We're using the Ritz cans as texture to make the face really dynamic. And, you know, this particular robot has about 10 different layers on top of it, 10 different layers of metal and plastic.
Really?
Yeah. So that's not something you normally see, but what we're doing is we're trying to make that work as a really dynamic head first. That, you know, we talked about this earlier, is the head is what's really important to the character, and that, you know, once we got that head all in shape, then everything else is built down from the head. Like this particular level right here, you see this is green, very specific color from a time frame period at that time. And it's a Prolon plastic plate. Now, those of you guys who've been around for a while will probably probably remember Prolon. It became Pro Brush in Florence, and they made, you know, plates, plastic plates, where they were just stamped. Actually, the plastic was this liquid, and they made these giant presses, and they pressed plates out. And
is that like melamine? Same thing?
Yeah, same thing.
Yeah, okay.
You know,
because I noticed a couple of them have this on there. Yeah.
Yeah, so that's where that layer comes from. So it all kind of fits together and as a shape and also a color thing.
And it kind of, this kind of reminds me of a leprechaun belt. I don't know why, you know. I mean, I just kind of, you know, with the buckle and the whole thing. And these crackers can almost be the skin tone, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, you can, when you look back at that, they lose the crackerness about them and they become like skin or wrinkles or something.
Right.
This is an older robot. I'm going to, does he have a name?
Well, this one's called the Olympic Green Robot. And the reason why it's called the Olympic Green, you know, there's various ways of naming them, but this particular shape right here is a thermos. And it's also probably from the 50s, you know, when you used to go on picnics, your family, you would have a big picnic basket, and you didn't have coolers back then so much as you had, you know, a thermos to keep your probably water, and you it was a you know couple gallon thermos, and everybody would pour it out. But the name of the thermos is called Olympic thermos. So
okay,
so it kind of gave me the idea, because it's kind of heroic in the sense that he's kind of, you know, a buff robot, and perhaps, you know, kind of godlike in a little way, you know, because of, you know, his posture.
He's definitely a buff robot. You would not want to get in his way, you know, absolutely. You know, as I'm looking around, and I go, of course, from my particular perspective, I'm looking for the specific female robots, you
right.
know, because you do genderize these
right.
guys. I mean,
right.
this guy is a guy. We already agreed on that. Do you have a female robot here? That
Yeah, we have a couple in a minute. We'll take a look
okay,
on them.
Good.
They're
good.
Up on top of the towers. But this one right here, let's see if I can get it without smashing them. Let's see. She's a girl, of course. She
Oh, yeah, she's got a skirt on.
Yeah.
Okay.
So this one right here is again, we're making them out of the Prolon bowls.
Yeah.
And this is a sugar bowl right here. And this is actually a little kind of serving bowl right here.
Mm-hmm.
These are plastic dishes. And the head right here is made out of a child's sand pail. It's a toy sand pail. And these were given away as gifts at the grocery store. You know, and the reason I know this is because the stickers were still on there in the beginning. You know, if you bought a certain amount of groceries, then you got a free, you know, a free little toy sand pail. And then this right here is a tea or sugar container. And it still has those kind of textures and colors from the 50s. And I just added this on, this fruit on her bodice right here. And that's from another different sugar container. So actually I cut that out and put this on. You know, those canister sets that, you know, every
oh, yeah.
kitchen has.
Oh my God, that's exactly what this
yeah,
is.
You have,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
you had one for flour,
one for sugar,
coffee,
one for coffee,
yeah, one for tea.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then on the bottom down here is a little drum, you know, with cartoon characters on it.
And that stabilizes her, right? Could she,
yeah.
would she be able to stand up and just,
no,
try? Yeah, because she's a little more, there's
yeah.
more to her. She's a little
yes.
heavier.
Yeah, you know, yeah. some of them I have that are freestanding,
mm-hmm.
And some have the bases. So mm-hmm. so I can play around with the different proportions, because, you know, these actually, this kind of interesting story for these arms. We do go to a lot of flea markets and tag sales, and occasionally I go to Brimfield, and probably everybody around here knows that Brimfield's a giant flea market in
oh, yeah.
area
oh, yeah.
over by Palmer,
mm-hmm.
and they have it three times a year. So we went one summer, and there was this giant display of carved you know, knights and fruit, and there was a little grandmother there sitting there, and her son had set up the booth for her and kind of left her, you know,
uh-huh.
and she was really sweet, but she had these about five or six boxes carved eggplants, you know, if you can imagine the shape of an eggplant, you know.
Really?
Right.
Okay.
And so they were wooden, and they were beautiful shapes. So I decided, well, maybe I could work the, you know, those into a robot. And, you know, maybe for the arms. For it, at that particular time, I was looking for different arm treatments. And so I brought them back, and I only had about a dozen. And then I began to look at them, and I said, well, I should have gotten more. So the next day I go all the way back to Brimfield and buy about 50 more. And she says, she was so excited to see me. She says, here's your little chair. Sit down. Sit down.
That's
and
nice
pick out your egg.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you might notice on some of them, like this Olympic green robot,
yeah. Yeah.
part of the arms
yeah.
are made out of eggplant carved shapes that I've kind of altered.
What's the name of the one you just showed us, the female?
I think I'm going to call her Elephant Girl. And the reason for that is there's an elephant on the base. You can see that.
Yeah.
A happy elephant. And there's an elephant right in her face up here. You know, it's a little harder to see, but, you know, she has two elephants, you know.
Well, so. I've got a name for her, too,
what's
you know,
that
I would like to give her, because she reminds me of Dora the Explorer.
So oh, really?
I think Dora is a great name for her.
Yeah.
You know, she's got that little exploration. And even the girl.
Safari
there,
hat.
Yeah, the safari hat. This guy, this girl, excuse me, because I think this is also female. She's mad at somebody because she's sticking her tongue out at somebody. But she's clearly of that metal early 50s
right.
aluminum look. But I just love this. Now, she's not finished yet. This is just the head.
No, this is just the head. And, you know, we're making it out of bread warmers and, you know, different, you know, kinds of cooking utensils. Mm-hmm. And this actually was a teapot, the bottom part. And I sawed off the spout. So you had that, you know, nice hole there. So I thought, you know, I'm putting her, you know, basically, you don't really see too many robots with tongues, so I thought I'd give it a try. So, so that's
I love.
We've
I
got
love
her
it.
Head
I,
going.
She's a sassy robot.
Yes,
this is a robot with an attitude.
Yeah.
I think what I'd like to do next, if it's okay with you, is I'd like to kind of go to some places around your studio and
sure.
point out some of the other ones that you have that are hidden away or on top, because they're really exciting. But before we do that, what I'd like to do is talk a little bit more about this and how people,
okay.
how you get
the material,
materials.
Yes.
Talk to us about this. Did somebody drop this off at your place or what?
Yeah, well, you know, we get lots of contributions and... you know, the things that we use all the time, you know, we can never have enough of. And those things that people say for me, it's really kind of touching and miraculous that I get so much from the community. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes it's from my wife's school kids at school. She teaches part-time art in mm-hmm. Leverett. Mm-hmm. And by the way, you know, without her inspiration and her help, you know, a lot of this doesn't happen up here. You know, it's, you know, I don't want to ever give the impression that this is all just about me. You know, it's, you know, it really is a collective effort.
Well, you've used the term we several times,
right,
so I
right.
figured that one
okay.
out.
Well, you know, one of the things that we do a lot of the time is make clocks, mm-hmm. you know, and some people might know about those and some people who are watching this mm-hmm. might not, mm-hmm. but we make, you know, thousands of clocks every year mm-hmm. Out of recycled and common materials, and they are sold all over the United States, and also, you know, I've heard, and also sent some, you know, all over the world, you know, like Brazil, Australia, Japan, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of nice to think that some little thing you make in your backyard in East Hampton can somehow have a life in Australia, say.
That's
for
great.
Us. Yeah,
that's
yeah,
great.
It is great. But, you know, these things, like, for instance, Altoid tins are one of the main shapes that we make a lot of the clocks out mm-hmm. of. And they are something that we can never have enough of. So if you have extra Altoid tins and you think you might want to donate them, then we'd be happy to take them, because they'll be made into clocks. Maybe in a minute I'll show you some of the things that we make out of Altoid tins.
Okay.
But other things that we need a lot of and can never have enough of are metal jar lids, you know. Because that's something that everybody uses all the time. And so a lot of people, my friends, my neighbors, they just have a little a place in their cupboard where after they wash the jar lid, they just save it and they get up, you know, maybe 20 or 30 jar lids, and then they just drop them off.
So you have a paper recycling, you have a tin and glass recycling, and you have a Mark Brown recycling.
That's right.
Right?
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then how do I know, I mean, where, you know, how do I go about getting them to you? What process?
All right. Well, that's a really important thing. We live here in East Hampton. We mm-hmm. live on Water Lane, on the corner of Water Street and Water mm-hmm. Lane. So if you live locally, you can just drop them off. Mm-hmm. Or if you want to call and ask. Our number is 527-9675.
Great.
So you can just call up and say, you know, I have a bunch of jar lids. Would you like them? And I'll say yes.
Okay. And we're going to cut away for a minute because what we're going to do is show you some more exciting pieces that Mark has developed, particularly for this robot. Say the name of the show again.
Robot Riot.
Robot Riot. I was going to say Robot Mania, but that's not right.
Right.
Robot Riot. And it's going to be November 9th from 5 to 8 is the opening, but they'll be there for a month at the Old Town Hall in the East Hampton City Arts Gallery. So I hope to see you all there. Thanks. Hi, we're back. And I've been spending hours scouring the studio with Mark to get some more things to show you that I think are really exciting. So I've got some things here, and we're going to go to a couple more places. Mark, tell us about Monkey Robot. I think he's Monkey Robot. Is he Monkey Robot?
Well, actually, he's Robot Monkey.
Oh, excuse me. Oh, okay. Robot Monkey.
He's a robot first and a monkey second.
Okay.
Okay. Well, this is what we were talking about earlier about the, you know, usage of silver and, you know, and those classic
aluminum, chrome. Yeah.
So, you know, all those shapes are out there. Mm-hmm. And I decided I would go back and try one because it had been a while since I tried one. So these, in a thematic sense, these are what some of the earlier ones look like. Of course, this is much different than the earlier ones I first made. But anyway, this is a thermos again. Mm-hmm. The middle part is a thermos. Mm-hmm. And then the head is different layers of, you know, tart molds and covers for thermoses and, you know, parts of coffee pots. And then the bottom part down here is feet. Or those are canteen holders.
They certainly, you know, are, yeah.
Little place where you put your canteen when you're a Boy Scout. And so it slipped right in. It actually had a little cloth cover at one point. But,
and, of course,
it's got the tail, right.
So I love his tail.
Right. And when we were talking about earlier, the Altoids. And the Altoids, we make at least a dozen different types of clocks out of Altoid tins. And this is the monkey clock. I didn't design this particular one, but it's a really great example of what we do with Altoid tins. And the back, of course, you can see
the Altoid. Yeah,
that's the cavity where the clock goes. And then the tail is made out of springs, and the hands are made out of spoons, and the feet are made out of forks. And there's the jar lid. Remember I was talking earlier about jar lids? Well, they turn into monkey heads and bottle caps for ears. So it's a really, really great design made by Jess, who no longer works here, but is, you know, one of my, you know, great designers in the studio. So
great. And you know what? This reminds me, this goes back in time, too, because either it reminds me of those little cigarette women. For some reason, the little cigarette women that used to go around and they had the little hats on the side,
right.
Or the Philip Morris guy from the old commercial, and they had the hat on the side, or even the monkeys that used to go around
organ
with the organ grinder
yes.
monkeys.
Yeah,
but this one's
so
a little snappier, you know.
Yeah.
He kind of belongs in another field. He's cute, very cute. And I got something here I'm holding, which is also going to be in the show, but this is a very different kind of thing. It looks like it's tin of some sort.
I was telling Marsha earlier that the original surface of this was a Mickey Mouse trash can. And if you look closely up here, you can see Mickey Mouse is still in the background right here. So basically, we cut the big trash can apart, and we used it because we have this, you can see right here, we have all these colored shapes, you know, that we use in the robots over here. Mm-hmm. And in order to make them from the raw wood into the colors, we prime them and then we paint them. So the background here is a surface, is a surface that we placed those shapes on and then sprayed them. So the background actually is those shapes. You can see where the shapes were on top of that. And then I was a painter for 20 years before I started doing three-dimensional work, And so I have great fondness for painting still. So I painted the robot on, and I left Mickey on here. And then I, because this was a cutout, we used that for one something else. I added this part on and did another. So there are three heads here. One's Mickey and two are robots. And, you know, some people kind of consider Mickey a sort of robot because because he has a, you know, he's not really quite human, but, you know, everybody relates to him. So anyway, there's going to be a couple of fun stuff like that in the show.
Oh, this is perfect.
Yes.
And we're going to go and find one of my favorite pieces in a minute, but we have to kind of move a little bit around the studio, so we'll be back in a flash, a robot flash.
Okay, well, this one is one of the oldest pieces that's going to be in the show. In fact, it may be the oldest piece. When I first started making things out of found materials, I made some early robots, and this is a cover for a bandsaw. And it was, you know, a pretty big bandsaw, kind of a, you know, industrial bandsaw. And so the shape is what I related to, that beautiful shape. And of course, I added the features on. And this is an iron. Everybody can probably see that. And then there are the reflectors, which, you know, kind of simulate the robot kind of idea, you know. So, but basically, it's just a big robot head, and it's been kind of hanging out here in the studio for the last 12 years or so. So it would be great to, you know, kind of put him in the show. So if you come to the show, then you'll
I'm thrilled him. Because yeah. I think he needs a home. I think yeah. he's been in yeah. here long enough. He's yeah. It's due, you know, and he's a senior robot, and I do have things about seniors. So, you know, I
well,
agree.
There's a few other things in the studio we're going to look in just a second over here. They've been hanging out in the studio for a long, long time. And one of the towers over here is made out of a capital A, if you can see that right here. This capital A was given to me about a dozen years ago. And it came off a store in Northampton. It was called Ann August. And everybody, I'm sure, remembers Jack August. It was a very famous seafood place, and its kind of companion down the street was called Aunt August, and it sold children's clothes, and it's right in the middle of Main Street there, kind of close to where the laundromat is. When I was making the towers, I wanted to make something a little out of the ordinary, and also with that, you know, kind of galvanized aluminum kind of coloring. So this one with the boy on top. He has telephones for arms. These are, you know, toy telephones, probably from the 50s also. And I just thought the coloration of the, you know, thermos, the blue thermos and the telephones and the big A, you know, really went together. And the bottom is a giant galvanized pail, and on top of it is one of those aluminum sleds, discs, that you used to, you know, fly down the hill on when you were kids and probably, you know, kill yourself on because you had no control. So all of these towers are made out of mostly things that were here in the studio, and I just kind of like the layering aspect. And if anybody watching has ever been to the Apollo Grill, great restaurant in Eastworks, my friend Casey has one of the original towers that I made at early on, and it's that one in the middle of the dining room with all the, you know, the teapots and coffee pots, and it's about 7 feet tall. So when I was doing the show, I saw that, you know, early on, and said that would be kind of fun to revive that idea, but now these are in color rather than just the silver and the black. So anyway, that's where these come from. You know, this was the first tower right here. And this is made out of trash can on the bottom, you know, two trash cans. You know, this is a Milwaukee Bucks trash can. Really fun old trash can. And then this is a tin drum, which was also a kind of cooler. You know, it's kind of funny the way these things work, but this has a top on it, and you could also put ice in it. And this is a beer can, a big beer can, and of course the globe. So I thought it'd be fun to put, a smaller robot kind of on top of the globe. So the difference in scale between the robot and the globe makes the little robot, seem really quite large. So.
Okay. You know, I was wondering, if I'm going to get one of these because I love them and I wanted to put them somewhere, could they go, what would happen outside? I mean, they're going
to
rust a little bit,
really
right?
Well, these are not really meant to go outside.
No, they're not, are they?
Yeah. I mean, some of them have galvanized elements in them, but these are not really meant to go outside. It'd be really great. I'm going to have one piece in the show that's, or maybe two, that have been outside for a long, long time. And one is like a 6-foot figure made out of a metal lawn chair. So it'll be
neat,
fun,
neat.
You know, if you have a big space, that'll be really
great.
Fun.
But
every part of the metal lawn chair was used in the figure. You know, the arms of the chair became the arms of the figure. The back of the chair became the head. The seat of the chair became the body. And the legs of the chair became the legs of the figure.
Right.
So that's kind of fun. You know, it's definitely, something that's been outside a while. But, yeah, most of these are inside pieces. And, maybe eventually I'll make a all outdoor one. But these are something that are meant to go inside. Kind of fun. You know, some of these still, as you can see, have the plates in them from Florence. And some are metal sap buckets, that are here from New England, for collecting the sap. They don't collect them in metal buckets anymore. They have the tubes and the plastic buckets. What else? You know, there's Charles cookies, they used to deliver the cookies and potato chips to your door,
right.
And then the girls on top up here, these are fun because they're really, really fun female shapes with heads that are made out of little, I think they were oftentimes used as sewing kits,
Really?
You put your sewing, your needle and your thread in them.
Yeah.
Or, picnic baskets. They had handles on them. They took the handles off, But it has this really funny, they have this really funny kind of Amish figures all over them. But, of course, now they don't look quite as Amish as they used to.
Well, I think this is going to be such a wonderful exhibit with all these different shapes and sizes and forms, ages. Some have been here for a while. Some are brand new.
Right.
Very exciting.
Right.
Again, it's going to be on November 9th at from 5 to 8. That's the opening, along with the art walk that's going on in East Hampton at the Old Town Hall, ECA Gallery.
Right.
It'll be up there for just about a month. And you can, if you didn't get a chance to go, you can stop in at some other time. All I can say is it's been great talking
with you, Marcia.
Mark.
Thank you for letting
me wander around this place and see all the wonderful things you have. And hopefully, if you have something you want to drop off, we gave you the phone number. You want to give it again?
Our number here is 527-9675.
Okay.
And thank you very much for
having
me.
Thank you. It's been great.
Yeah.